deal because they know that when you find something like that, water means that life could have been there. Well, they could sort of look here and get equally excited, I think. Because in the earth, water is life. It exists. Water's basic to our well-being and our prosperity. Drinking it nourishes us. Using it sustains us. And the need to protect it compels us to action. That's actually what compelled EPA to come into being. So we need to stop looking at the sky and start looking at the earth and figure out what we do with our own resource so we can sustain life as we've come to know it. But I know that I'm preaching to the choir, so I don't need to say a lot more about that, but I do need to acknowledge that most of the water issues, when they're played out, there's a lot of drama about what we do at the federal level. But you know as well as I do that the rubber meets the road in water at the local level. You know, I've been doing this work for a long time. I worked for local communities. I worked for the state in Massachusetts. I went over to work in Connecticut running the environmental agency there. And I know that where the local communities are where the action is. It's your communities, it's your companies, it's your cutting edge innovation, like the innovation that you're celebrating today, that is going to make or break our ability to act as a sustainable society, to figure out not only how we preserve our water and our drinking water, but how we manage it in the face of changing times. And I want you to know that EPA is here as a partner with you in these efforts. We are designing programs and we are building support that we want to help you do your jobs more successfully. And all together, as of 2013, the Drinking Water State Revolving Funds have delivered more than $25 billion in total assistance projects. But we know resources are strained. We have to fight for these resources every day, and we need to do that together. But there is one thing that I want to call to your attention. It's the thing that President Obama has called, I think, to this nation's attention in the most visible and vocal way that he could. And that is that we are facing a changing climate. And that changing climate has a ripple effect on all of our resources and on our ability to live sustainably. But it most importantly drives some challenges with our water systems and with our ability to maintain those and to work within the resources we have. Our issues become more complex because of a changing climate. That's why the president went out with a climate action plan. He didn't do it just for the fun of it and to drive everybody crazy. He did it because it's necessary to think comprehensively and sustainably about how we look at our many challenges, recognizing that we're dealing with a future that must be carbon constrained, and we're dealing with a climate that is already changed. It is already changed. And a huge piece of that change revolves around water. Too much water, too little water. Too high intensity storms, too many droughts. We are facing it at levels that we've not seen before and more frequently than we ever anticipated. And your organizations will continue to face the challenges relating to this changing climate as you prepare for your fifth year in a row of 100-year storm events. When that happens, you gotta rethink the title as well as the strategy. And you'd better believe that when issues like Hurricane Sandy hit, the last thing in the world we want to do is to go back and rebuild the infrastructure that was damaged exactly the way it was before. We must rebuild it in a way that recognizes the storms we are going to be facing, the sea level rise that is happening, and the ways in which we need to build resiliency into the systems that we are rebuilding over and over, in hopes that we only have to rebuild them once for the long haul. So our challenge is to make sure that people are planning and designing with climate change in mind. And that's a new norm for all of us. That's the good news, is that we can actually work together to make this happen. We can work together to recognize this common interest in a way that will allow us to face our challenges of clean drinking water and safe water to live, work, and play in a way that will ensure its sustainability. But you are the experts. You're the experts in the cities and towns. And EPA is just here to help. We obviously think we have some expertise in this issue to offer as well. But we know that you're the driver that's going to identify the challenges. You are often the innovator that's going to drive those solutions. But we are going to design programs to support your efforts. That's what we are all about. Now, we have our climate-ready water utilities and our climate-ready estuaries programs. That's to give managers the knowledge and resources on how to manage water in an integrated way. We have our climate resiliency evaluation and awareness tool. What does that do? That assists drinking water and wastewater utility operators by delivering climate threats and their risks into an accessible software tool so that we can understand how to assess those risks so we can better manage them, we can better mitigate them, and we can work together. Now, second, EPA has a framework specifically designed to promote the kind of integrated planning that helps cities prioritize wastewater and stormwater projects. Why is that important? Because we all live with limited resources. Now, what do we call this? A very unusual and innovative name. We call it our integrated planning framework. Third, we have to keep leaning on the creativity and common sense that comes with green infrastructure solutions that can treat, manage, and use our water in a sustainable way. You know, the science and economic case for green infrastructure is just getting clearer and clearer as communities act, as green infrastructure is driven into the systems on a daily basis, and as we're able to gather the science, all we see is positive results. There are economic cases in 13 communities. They range from big cities like New York and Seattle to smaller communities like Lenexa, Kansas, and West Union, Iowa. I don't care if you're a big city or you're a rural community. There's ways in which we can show that green infrastructure can save money and can make delivering environmental health and social benefits more effective and efficient. And so we are going to continue that work together. And last, I want to make a point about innovation, because that's really what tonight is all about. This room and in the rest of the nation, we're filled with innovators and problem solvers. And that's why we're gathered. These are the people that think outside the box, or maybe I should say outside the pipe, for a crowd like this. EPA's Office of Water is committed to cultivating and supporting that creativity. Last March, we released a blueprint for integrating technology innovation into the National Water Program. It was such a tremendous hit. People really liked it. They found it had great value. It challenged them in ways they wanted to be challenged and provided them information that would allow them to do their jobs more effectively. So what did we do? We decided that we should do it again. So I'm thrilled to announce that today we're releasing our second blueprint. It highlights our plans to promote technology innovation across water programs. The blueprint highlights energy reduction and recovery at drinking water and wastewater facilities. Why do we care about that? Because the 150,000 drinking water and 15,000 wastewater facilities nationwide account for almost 2% of the national electricity consumption. Why does that matter from a carbon perspective? That's a lot of CO2, folks. Why does it matter to all of you? Because if you want to invest money, you have to save money. And this is exactly what this does for the folks that run these facilities, for the cities and the towns that depend on them, and for the consumers that need that water to deliver to them cost effectively. That's enough power for 6.5 million homes. 6.5 million homes a year to be lit up all year long. And we also want to focus on improving the reliability of small drinking water systems, because over 90% of the 160,000 public water supply systems are small. They're serving less than 3,300 people. Now, we can decentralize, but we can't be disorganized about it. We have to provide the tools that will make this happen effectively. That's what this blueprint is all about. So with that, let me just give a shout out to all of the winners for their creativity, for their ingenuity. They're all not just thinking about providing clean water today. They're thinking about what it takes to manage clean water for future generations. That kind of ingenuity breaks down barriers, and it provides models for collaboration, just as that little video indicated. It sparks increased investment in innovation. It sparks better management, better measurement. Everything you are celebrating today are things that we should celebrate every day, because we work in a program that sustains life. If we do not have water for drinking, safe water for drinking, then we have turned too much attention to the skies and not enough attention to the things that matter here on Earth. I thank you for everything you do. I congratulate the winners. Good night.